Thank you very much, ma'am. To all of us, good afternoon, and I would like to say that maybe this afternoon will be a learning experience for me. My topic is the logic of Rice Family and ethnography of Harding Village in Mindanao. Perhaps like many of you, my participation in rice industry is basically a consumer. Until this study came, I would like to say that this presentation, warn you, that this presentation would not dazzle with your theories, formulas, or anything. What I'll be doing here is, I would like to believe that Gaya ng Nags, okay, we have one friends here. I am tempted to speak in the vernacular. When I started my master's in 2008, my research advisors told me that you should look at research as like storytelling. What you are doing in your research is building on to the stories that preceded your story. And in coming up with this story, it is not your story that should be highlighted. It's the story of people you meet, the story of scholars you meet, and the stories of colleagues you meet. So basically what I'll be doing this afternoon is to tell you the stories of farmers in the farming village where I stayed. And my personal encounter, and I would say it's my personal Damascus, like the conversion. And third, perhaps in the last, it's the very last slide, to do an analysis of sociology. The thesis. I would like to argue the disconnect between the state and the village perpetuates the poverty in the farming village. First controversy. The title of my presentation is The Logic of Rice Farming. But the main thesis is the disconnect between the village and the state and the perpetuation of poverty. I would like first to speak about the methodology I used. As Ma'am Nova said, I joined Field Rice in 2009, right after I came up for my master's degree. And I first joined Field Rice in Sayat, in North Cotabato. And in the mid-2010, because of need, I was transferred to Field Rice Agusan, in Agusan del Norte. And my first job in Agusan del Norte was to look at the documents, reports, technical reports, liquidation, and everything regarding a technical cooperation project within JICA and Field Rice, which looked at the farming villages which adapted Palayamanan, if you're familiar with that. So my initial knowledge about the community was through the reports I read. And in that report, what caught my attention was that, like any other report, it's all roses. Beautiful, dramatic, convincing that it really moved the community forward. But in the number of times that I went to the community to verify, I did not see the changes, I did not see the reality spoken about in the report. So, around that time as well, I was being offered a scholarship or PhD. And so I thought of that. Perhaps I could write about this. And my first proposal actually was to do a livelihood systems analysis. Why there was an apparent failure of the project to address the issue it actually intended to do in the first place. So that's what was my initial knowledge about the community. Second, during my stay in the community, I stayed there for 18 months, being in the community. I stayed there for 18 months and I became a farmer. I rented a farm, a half hectare, which I planted for three cropping seasons. That's why I said it's a conversion on my part to stay in the place, and you would realize later on. The third one is ethnography. I use ethnography using refugees. Focus group discussions, talking about gender, talking about family life, talking about farm life, talking about community life, the political disconnect and everything. But the third one, the second method that really was helpful to me was the journals. I did my journals in the same way that I advised my respondents to do the journals. So, what I have my thesis with me. What is written in my thesis actually notes from the journals of my respondents. Only when theories are necessary, which I use, that I write about them. Why is journal important to us? Because we were able to trace the first day, from the first day that we met until the day I left the community, we were able to trace what changes we have in our household, what changes we had in our community, what changes we had in our farm. Be it technological, be it communal, be it personal, and be it social. The third one is the informal interviews. I interviewed farmer leaders, rice traders, rice millers, input suppliers, government extension workers, city agricultural office services staff, and informal conversations. Many researchers would frown at informal conversations because they would argue it's not scientific. But for me, it's the best thing that really captured my experience and what I wanted to write about, what I wanted to know. In my experience, when I first asked the farmers about any issue, you can verify this if you do your own research, and if you are really immersed in the community. If you ask a farmer about an issue, about a topic, especially about development topic, the first thing that they will tell you is the thing that they think you wanted to hear. They would not tell you the reality that's running within the household, that's running within the community. My apologies to those who do not understand the vocabulary. Sasabihin ng mga magsasaka sa'yo ang bagay na sa palagay nila ay gusto mong marinig. Hindi yung dapat mong marinig. This is one lesson I learned from this research. And to verify my experience, I had conferences with the advisor and colleagues. When I say colleagues, my classmates, because I was staying in the Philippines, my classmates and other colleagues, and while they are in Australia, while they were in all over the world doing their own research, we have Skype conferences on Wednesdays. So that's the methodology. Okay. The research side. Who is from Mindanao here?
San ka sa Mindanao?
Kabakan.
Ah, Kabakan. North Cotabato. Nobody's from Caraga. This is the research site. And that is Butuan City proper. Okay. What you see, ito, is the Agusan River. The second largest tributary in Mindanao. I think this is the second. First is the Rio Grande. So ito. Ito yung nakikinig, what you see here. Ito. The letter L is the road, access road to the community. And this is the national highway, actually bypass road. And that's the city proper. And the city is around 8 kilometers away from, and the village is away from, is around 8 kilometers away from the city. So roughly, it's a larger site. So, dirt road, this one. These are the rice fields. Dirt road is also served as the mega dike. This is an elevated road, 2 meters elevation. The research site is a farming village in Butuan City, a highly urbanized city. I would like to emphasize this, because you would think that if it's a highly urbanized city, you think of it as all rosy, all progressive, and everything that is good in being a city. One of the 86 barangays with 3 sub-villages. So, most, 74% of the population are farmers. When I say farmers, general one, let's call farmers, those involved in the falcata industry, call them farmers, rice farmers. More traditional with less or minimal mechanization. And socially and environmentally challenged community. Babalikan natin, bakit siya environmentally challenged? Diba? Napakalapit niya lang sa history, it's very close to the river. So, ano pag-usapan natin ngayon hapon? What shall we talk about this afternoon? I would like to propose a triad. Itong triad na ito, hindi hinahanapan ang patuha. Wala itong patuha. In my experience, and this triad represents 2 chapters of my thesis. Dalawang chapter lang ito ng aking thesis. First, I would like to speak about poverty and the logic and rhetoric of rice farming and the state-village dynamic. Sa akin kasi, for me, it's the triad that captures my experience and the experience of the farmers in the village. So how do I propose to do this? Like, first, I would like to speak about poverty. I'm not speaking about poverty of the household. I'm speaking about the general poverty in the community. Access road. The access road, though it's a mega dike to serve as prevention from, as protection from the water overflow from the Agusan River when it rains and floods, it's a dirt road. Ang lalaki ng butas, and the only means of transportation going to and from the village to the city is the habal-habal. If you're familiar with the habal-habal, the single motorbike. You see them see four-wheeled vehicles there, unless they are service of the government employees or government workers going to the village. Unsafe water. I stayed in the village for 18 months and I stayed in a Nipa house I actually rented. And right beside my house is a water pump. Tawag nila sa one is jet money. If you're familiar with that, yung binubomba. That's the source of water in the community. You have around 20 of that in the community. And yun na ang ginagamit ng families for cooking, for washing, and even for drinking. But in my case, I did not do that because of the third one, yung threat of cystosomiasis. Kung familiar kayo sa sakit ng cystosomiasis, ito yung lumulong buntian. Infection ito, I think it's viral infection na that sometimes meron siyang epileptic-like symptoms and it's fatal. So, nakukuha ito usually, you can get this usually from the rice field. Kasi ang vector nito ay yung mga snails. Sa community, marami kang makikita ng akalang bubuntis kahit lalaki. So, it's the face of poverty. And how do you prevent that? I think there's the only prevention now that we have in the village is every year, everybody goes to the health center to take the vaccine, oral vaccine. So, ginawa na sa kanya. And the hiring of school dropouts. Ang taas ng porsyento ng after elementary, hindi na mag-high school. There are three elementary schools in the village, because there are 3 sitios in the village, the upper Tarabaca, lower Tarabaca, and central Tarabaca. So I was in the lower Tarabaca. And after elementary, mahirap ang mapag-high school. The reason being, there's no high school within the village. Second, the nearest one is in the city, which requires daily spending for the family. Or Another one is in the neighboring village San Vicente, which you can only, which the easiest access is to cross the Luzon River by outrigger. So, ang taas ng portion doon ang dropout. So after high, after elementary, I think around 40, the high of 40% going to high school. So high school pa lang yan. So, ang taas ng dropouts. So these are the phases of material poverty I saw in the village. And these are the phases of material poverty shared by farmers. They don't talk about hunger. They don't talk about lack of food or lack of shelter or lack of education. Though none of us are those. These are the material poverty. But sa akin, for me, the more disturbing poverty is a structural one. Babalikan ko yung sabi ko, I was working in Lower Tagabaha. Lower siya kasi nasa baba nga siya kasi yung ibang Tagabaha, akyat, ang dadaling doon is Tagabaha. And if you can recall in the map, the village is very near the river. It's like a catch basin. And the dirt road, elevated mega dike, which serves as a protection from the water from the river, is also cursed to the community. Why? Because it's the village is near the mountain ranges in Agusan del Sur, Bukidnon area. And all the waters coming from Bukidnon and Agusan, and even Compostela Barilla, Davao region, goes to the village. Now, because of the elevated mega dike, the water is not able to flow out of the community. So, the flood is not from the river, but from up the mountains in Agusan del Sur, Bukidnon, and Davao region area. So, ano ang karanasan ko sa baha? Sometimes when I first talk about this and I presented this experience of flood, in, I think it was in Pinrice. Naiyak ako. Why? Binaha kami January 5, 2014. That's the, sabi ng, the people were saying that's one of the most devastating floods in the last 20 years. The rain started around midnight. And I think it's normal rain because Agusan Caraga area, specifically Agusan del Norte, as a climate type 4, so the wet and very wet. Talagang ulan, kung hindi mo ulan ang ulan. So bihira ka makakita ng sunlight. Now, so the rain started to pour at around midnight, then at around 4 o'clock, biglang may nag-alert sa amin, taga-upagat, taga-uhit sa mga community, na may baha na. So, natural yung baha. Sana yung mga tao. So, okay lang, we took it matter-of-factly. Then around 5, after an hour, yung bahay na nire-rentahan ko ay hindi na ako mapasok kasi hanggang Linggo na. So, hindi lang ako. I have neighbors. So we stayed overnight in the elevated megadike. The road became our shelter. With sacks, dahon ng sagay, kung anong dahon nakita namin. Wala kaming kapal, wala kaming tarpaulin. So yung laptop ko, naiwan ko sa, I left my laptop in the house, wala. Hindi ba pakinabangan, mga ganito, wala. So overnight, we slept. Ako nakatayo, hindi ako makatulog, etc. The thing is, I'm single. Wala akong, hindi ka tarpaulin mo. Then, the day came, first day. Nandun pa rin kami. Second day, nandun pa rin kami. So we're living on whatever we had before the flood. Only after 4 days, the local government came. 4 days. Remember, may mga bata sa community. There are small kids. 4 days. It took 4 days for the local government to come to us. To the most vulnerable community, 4 days, considering it's an 8-kilometer distance. For me, it's a spiritual poverty. The second level of poverty is pagdating doon, documentation. Then the next day, mayroong relief. Anong gagawin sa relief? Pipila. So there's no system kung paano distribute yung relief. Ako, nakakuha ng 4 kilos na rice, 2 balot ng sardinas, eh 2 latang sardinas, 2 balot ng noodles. Yung katabi kong pamilya, mayroong 4 na anak, same. 4 kilos of rice, 2 sardines, and 2 noodles. Social equity. So, kaya nga sinasabi ko, ang experience ng club na ito para sa akin is a loss of different levels. Nawalan ka na ng dignidad. Nawalan ka ng pag-asa kasi nakikita mo, binabaha ang rice field mo. Your rice field is flooded. What hope do you have? That you know, people in Butuan know, or people in North Tagabaca specifically know, that when it's flooded in January, mag-re-receive ang flood by February. So, loss of many levels. So, sa akin, it's a pressing question. Sa gitna ng poverty ito, sa gitna ng kahirapan ito, is rice farming logical? Or, why plant rice? Kasi parang ang layo, di ba? Hindi naman masusunod ng rice farming ang ban eh. Ang problema sa demokrasya. Hindi naman masusunod ng rice farming ang problema sa sisto, sa sakit. Yung unhealthy life. So bakit sa akin may logic yung rice farming? So ano yung logic ng kanilang pagsasaka? Because rice farming is a household enterprise, economic enterprise. Kaya na ipapalutan ng isang magsasaka ang kanyang pagsasaka dahil bahagi yan ng pagkakagastusan niya sa kanyang household. At bakit niya pinagkakagastusan niya? Because it's an investment. Dahil diyan nakakakuha siya ng panggasto sa pagpapaaral, kung ipapaaralin siya, for food, and even for other expenses. It's so nakakatuwa. It's so glorifying to see that kahit baon sa utang ang farmer, pagkatapos ng anihan, bibili ng isang piraso ng appliance. Diba? Nakakatuwa. Baon siya sa utang, sa input, pero at the end of the cropping season, pagkatapos siya ng harvest, pagkatapos ng benta, bibili ng cellphone yung anak. Bibili ng maliit na cassette, yung TV, yung DVD player, bibili ang farmer. Magpapayos ang isang bintana, magpapalit ng kontina. Because it's an economic enterprise that helps the family go on. Ito ang nagustuhan ko kasi hindi ko naman ito naisip noon eh. May expression ng mga Bisaya dito. If anybody speaks Cebuano, ang yuta, dili mata. The land will never decay. So, land is a perpetual resource. May lupa ako, sasakahin ko na lang yan. Gagamitin ko yan sa pagpapalay. Bakit ko gagamitin sa pagpapalay at hindi sa pagbubulay? Wala namang kasihong nagpapautang sa akin na kapitalista sa pagtatalim ng bulay. So, rice farming. Nandun yung logic. Gagamitin yung lupa sa rice because somebody can finance my rice farming. Land is my perpetual resource. Kaya nga, kahit hirap sila, binabayaran nila yung lupa nila. Kasi itong community, it is an agrarian reform beneficiary na community. So, binabayaran nila sa bangko hanggang 25 years para magpaka nila yung lupa. And I think bayad na sila 2016 yan, last year. And rice is a currency for exchange. It's a commercial tool. Kaya nung sinabi ko, pwede mong ibenta yung palay mo, yung bigas mo. So it's surprising that after harvest, it's seldom that farmers leave a sack or even a bag for their consumption. So everything goes to the trader. Pag kailangan nila mamusulo, bibili sila ng bigas. So rice is the major currency of exchange. So dependent on the dependent there. And even in the middle of the reform infrastructure, nagsasaka pa rin sila. Sira yung irrigation system, hindi makapasok yung tubig sa kanila, nagwater po. magsasaka. Because for them, rice is important. It's a household enterprise, and you have the land as perpetual resource, and it's the major currency for exchange. Ano yung logic? Sinasabi ko ito kasi minsan may disconnect eh. I don't criticize government or any institution for that matter. But I think this is one of the things that we fail to address with the extension board. Na the mentality or the psychology of farmers is quite far from what we know. Kasi sabi nga ng, I would like to hold my wife here. There have been technological hypochondria running for almost decades now. So, great strength. Rice farming as a reflection of social order. Gusto ko talaga yung ito yung relationship ng farmer at ng trader o yung kapitalista. Alam naman ang mga magsasaka na may degree of oppression sa kanilang relationship, sa kanilang pagpapautang. Alam na mga magsasaka na nakakatulong din ang mga kapitalista, ang mga rice trader at papautang sa kanila. The question that I asked was, siguro na-raise rito questions, but hindi kayo mangutang sa sinasabi ng government financial institutions? Alam mo ang sagot ng magsasaka? Hindi kayo pwede mangutang sa bangko kasi kailangan tulong pa sa bangko. Itong si Trader A, masalam mo namin sa daan, sabihin namin na, sir, kailangan ko ng pera siguro sa makakawa. Pwede bang reservahan mo ako? Sa daan pwede ko siyang sabihin. Nakasando ako, nakachinelas ako, pwede ko siyang punta. Sa bangko, mahihiyang punta na ako. Ano ba? Ano bang dahilan? Sa bangko kasi, sir, ganito. Nandiyan siya, may table na makintap na parang ayaw mo lang inapag ito yung siko. Again, it's the distance. If we do extension work, think of that. If we frame that, we frame our promotion or extension services along those lines. So it becomes an issue with social capital. Kasi pag trader, halimbawa ako ay mangungutang, si Sir ay trader, at kaibigan ko si Ma'am Nova, kailangan niya rin ng pera, pwede akong pumadrino sa kanya para makalapit siya kay Sir Nova. So, sa bangko, parang ito yung sinasabi ko, may sa bangko. You cannot easily do it. Pero sa trader, pwede. So, the formalities or the absence of it sa relationship, malaking bagay ang isang problem. Which, unfortunately, is not captured by our extension modalities. So, it then becomes an issue with empowerment. Sino may control sa resources? At bakit niya nakokontrol? At hanggang saan ang control niya sa resources? The state and the village dynamics. Merong isang nagsasabi doon sa karanasan ko sa may isang kasing leader doon na vocal siya. Ang tingin niya sa estado ay malaking tagatulak ng economic development. Siya ang tinawag ko nalang agent of socio-economic change. Siya, parang siya ang prime mover. Yun ang paniniwala niya. Kasi nung time na yun, malakas yung CCT sa community. Yung 4Ps. Hindi ko alam kung ibig sabihin ng 4Ps. Alam ko siya as CCT, yung conditional cash transfer. Yung 4Ps, hindi ko alam kung ano yung ibig sabihin. Basta pantawid, ang tawag nila pantawid. So malakas, yun ang tinitingnan niya. Na dahil doon, siya ang state ang nagdi-dictate ng socio-economic direction. So, state says agenda. Dahil siya nagkocontrol ng agenda, siya rin nagkocontrol ng resources. Kailangan mong humingi. Kailangan mong pumunta. Hindi ka naman namamalimos, pero kailangan mong magdala ng proposal. Kailangan mong mag-negotiate. Dinagdag niya, pero ang madali yung estado ay si self-check. Kasi tinitingnan niya na, kasi nung time na ito, maraming issues ng corruption na lumalabas sa TV naman. Hindi na sabi niya, yung mga magnanakaw, napabantayan mo ng gobyerno. Parang,
gobyerno, yung the government or the state is doing a self-check. Parang chine-check niya yung sarili niya, may control niya siya. And nagdulot nadala ito sa akin sa thinking na siguro sa mata ng mga magsasaka, and I verified this student, meron silang dalawang pananaw tungkol sa Estado as a separate, autonomous entity. Hiwalay yan sa amin. Kailangan namin lumapit yan, kailangan makipag-usap yan. So hindi kami yan. Nandito kami, nandiyan sila, nandun sila. Again, the distance, political distance. May sarili siyang batas kasi kailangan namin, kumbaga kasi, paghihingi kami, if you want to ask, we have to follow their checklist. So yun. Yung pangalawa naman is the state as embodiment of society. Nahabi ang contestation ko naman, no, they cannot decide kung hindi naman sila papayagan kasi nga, bumoboto tayo. We elect them. So yun, ito yung dalawang view ng state na nangampan sa community. As a separate, autonomous, and the counter argument is embodiment of society. Kung ano tayo, yan din ang Estado. Ang challenge dito sa community is, asaan ba yung equilibrium at paan tayo makakapunta? Ito rin ang gusto kong bigyan ng din ngayon dahil with recent development, kaya re-frame ko itong actually, I think this is the last slide. O second to the last. Nandito tayo ngayon sa tinatawag nating the dilemma of dual transition. Pansin nyo ba, tuwing after election, national elections, we are back to square one. It's either we fix the system or go for the gold. Ano example ng we are fixing the system? Pinapakulong natin yung managkasala. Hindi masama magkulong, pero naka-stuck tayo dun. Nauubos yung resources natin, yung energy natin as a nation, as a government, as a state, starting all over again. Wala kayong continuity. And second is, yung challenge na, gusto ba talaga natin go for the gold? O may stuck lang tayo sa fixing the system? That is always our dilemma as a nation, as a people. Every after election, local man or national. Ito ang napansin ko. Right after election sa Butuan, napalitan ang alcalde, ibang direction din siya. So he has to fix the system, and the ideology or the intention or objective going for the full development na sites na sa check na lang muna. So naisang tabi na naman. 3 years came, iba na naman ako. Ganun tayo eh. So ano yung way forward natin? Ito lang ang theory dito. Ito ang pinapropose ko. Yung idea ni Foucault tungkol sa government. Ang sinabi ni Foucault ay, a government is the conduct of conduct. Para mag-move forward ang government, kailangan niya munang ayusin ang sistema niya sa loob. At pag naayos niya na yan, saka siya mag-maintain ng order. Mahirap gawin ito kasi sa atin politically ay napaka-wide ang latitude ng ating wide natin spectrum sa politics. Mahirap tayo mag-fix sa system. Kaya nga, tingnan natin ngayon sa gobyerno, kanya-kanyang takbo, kanya-kanyang department. Hindi naman ito naiiba sa mga nauna ng gobyerno. Parang iisa lang ang takbo nila pag nagsosona na. Pero after the sona, kanya-kanyang takbo. Reflective ito sa community. After ng program, ng technical cooperation program, doon sa community, kanya-kanya na. Nagtanim yung gusto magtanim, nagpatuloy ng palayamanan yung gusto magpatuloy ng palayamanan. Yung iba, nagfalkata na, inabado na totally yung rice farming. Kasi, we are constantly in the mode of fixing the system. And second is person's view of power. Ang sinasabi lang ni person ay, para maayos natin ang ating lipunan, kung sino man ang may control ng resources, though siya ang mag-dictate, dapat ang impetus ng kanyang dictation, ng kanyang direction, ay the attainment of the common goal. Madali lang daw ito gawin, sabi ni Parsons, if the village
controls the same. So I leave you with a thought and thank you.